Okay, so I make that just about time to start. So can I just first and foremost welcome everyone to Alzheimer Europe's conference and to this session on post-diagnostic support. We have four speakers today. My intention is to introduce each of the speakers and go through each of the presentations. And we will leave time at the end of the presentations for some discussion and questions. Just to tell you too, that the platform for the conference platform has been some problems with the function in there for asking questions. So for this session, we're going to use the Zoom chat facility, which is in the presentation. So if you have any questions, throughout the presentations, you can drop them in there. I'll keep an eye on those. The speakers may wish to respond to questions that are directed to them through the chat. And if there are some which are brought up that maybe generate some discussion, I will maybe try and highlight those as part of the conversation at the end. So without further ado, can I introduce our first speaker, who is Shirley Evans from the UK. And Shirley's presentation is entitled, How Can Meeting Centres Support People Affected by Dementia to Adjust to Change During a Period of Physical Distancing? Thank you, Shirley.
Thank you very much, Jim. I hope you can all hear me. And just checking that I can forward my slides. So yes, I'm going to talk about meeting centres and how they had to change since, in fact, the 23rd of March when we had to close our doors. I'm Shirley Evans. I'm from the Association for Dementia Studies at the University of Worcester. And I'm also a trustee of Leinster Meeting Centre. And I spend most of my working time over the last 6 years and my spare time working on meeting centres. I'm going to tell you a little about what a meeting centre is, what the adjusting to change or adaptation coping model is, and then say about how meeting centres adapted. A little bit about our study and what we might learn for future practice. And there's just some photographs from Leinster Meeting Centre, obviously not this year, at the end of last year at our fete outside our meeting centre, bottom left, out and about in the community and in the meeting centre. And I guess the main thing about meeting centres is that a lot of it is around people being face to face in a group and socializing and having a good time together. But it's also about people with mild to moderate dementia generally living at home in the community, an inclusive and friendly focus on both the person with dementia and the family carer. It's a social club, usually three days a week, but in the UK some are open for less in rural areas. But for around 5 hours a day. But it's very important that they're regular and ongoing. So it's useful to think about some of these aspects of translating those into the current climate and what is and isn't permissible. Very local, accessible, and it's no us and them. It's just an ordinary life setting. People would say it's like going into a family. When you go into the meeting centre, you don't know who people with dementia carers, staff, visitors are. It's great. Generally, supporting 16 to 20 people a day, plus family. And at Leinster, for example, we do have those numbers. So sometimes it gets up to around 25 people and then it's very busy. And that's sort of the maximum people that you'd want there. Otherwise, it's quite difficult to engage and can be overwhelming. The activities are determined by the needs and aspirations of the members, with everybody contributing in some way. Generally, staffed by a centre manager, a coordinator, support work and volunteers. So at Leinster, where I am, it's in Herefordshire on the Welsh borders, there's a manager, a deputy manager, sort of coordinator, and a support worker at any one time, and some volunteers, usually about two or three there. Lots of outreach into the local community. A meeting centre works both sides of the door, going out and about, visiting different attractions and heritage sites, and people coming in as well. Ongoing collaboration between local stakeholders, both in the planning and implementation stages, not replicating what else is going on. We've got research evidence with the going back of the 20 years from that of Professor Rosemary Dres and with the Meeting Den project, for example. And it's about helping people to adapt and adjust well to living with dementia, underpinned by this, as I mentioned, adaptation and coping model, which we call the adjusting to change model in the UK. So one thing I've been working on and thinking about is how can that continue in this current climate? So the adjusting to change model, it's about practical adjustment, understanding and empowerment, emotional adjustment, sort of improving the emotional well-being, and the social adjustment, building social opportunities. Can all of this be continued in the current climate, and particularly from March to June, the middle of June, where there was no face-to-face contact at all? So that's what we wanted to look at. So, yeah, on the 23rd of March, meeting centres across the UK, there are 13 of those at the moment, quite a number under development, and are quite a number actually, you know, continuing to develop, and we're hoping for more to be opening next year. But we closed our doors, and during that time, four of the meeting centres, at least, the demonstrator sites, as we call them, across the UK, so that's Leinster, Droitwich Spa, Kirriemuir in Scotland, and Powys in Wales, we continue to provide a substantial amount of support with no staff not furloughed. We continued with the full staffing. And these are the sort of contacts that we had. There are sort of lots of telephone calls. The use of post was very important. WhatsApp and FaceTime for individual discussion and consultation. Use of Zoom for one-to-one meetings and for group meetings, sort of carer meetings, as well as the use of Zoom to replicate what might normally take place in the meeting centre, activities, quizzes, I don't know, lots of things like card bingo and just general chat and just having a good time. And a home garden visits we were able to pick up again at the end of June. So they started happening. So there was a little bit of face-to-face as well as with delivering shopping and such like. Very important to have that face-to-face, face-to-face contact. So we obviously collected in our study the nature of this contact and the types of contact. But as you will appreciate as we go forward, that not everybody has is digitally enabled. And so I would say at Leinster, about between 30 and 40% of people have the technology, and obviously then the majority do not. And that's something that needs to be thought about. We also carried out interviews and focus groups with a number of stakeholders at the meeting centre, there with members and family carers, with the four managers, with staff and volunteers and trustees, to get an overview and answer questions like, can the meeting centre continue to support people to adjust to change? So after carrying those out, we mapped those types of contact and the example activities that were enabled by these types of contact against the adjusting to change strategies. So you can see cognitive stimulation, physical exercise, optimizing choice and control, information and signposting, relaxation and fun, building confidence, opportunities to talk to others who understand, opportunities to engage with others in a relaxed atmosphere, and supporting others through similar experience, so that peer support and effective help seeking. So we were really interested to see whether these aspects of the adjusting change model could be enabled. As you can see, I'll just give an overview. So the Zoom, and this might be glaring the obvious really, but the only way during lockdown that you could have a group meeting was via Zoom, basically. So that enabled carer support. That was fantastic for some carers that usually weren't able to engage in a group support session, were able during Zoom. It gave flexibility and enabled the choir to continue in some places and those other relaxation activities. So that use of Zoom enabled all of those adjusting to change strategies to be put in place. And the home garden visits, as did that face-to-face contact. And the only thing that couldn't easily be enabled there during full lockdown was that peer support with, you know, more than two or three people. So we found this very insightful. And looking here now at some of those examples, newsletters were used by all the meeting centres on a regular basis, either weekly, fortnightly and monthly, and one meeting centre producing up to 40 pages a week with different newsletters. And from the feedback I got, you can't underestimate how important those newsletters were. Quite difficult to produce, very labour intensive, and lots of paper, lots of printing. But people were still hand delivering them, or they were posting them, but they were really felt to be really valuable because it's something that arrives for your letterbox. It's not a bill, and it's something that people have in their hands, you know, and then people were contributing to the newsletters as well, their own photographs and recipes and articles. So it was really helped to optimize choice and control. Same, and also with the newsletters, cognitive stimulation, but also that this regular contact with meeting staff and that contact that's outside the meeting centre as well, sometimes meeting people in their garden, gave a different perspective and also developed relationships in a different way, and also gave people a different focus from their everyday life there. And so moving forward, when we got to August, in England anyway, we were able to open up the meeting centre a little, and we had six members there at any one time and three members of staff. We've moved back a bit now, so we have four members, two members of staff, and the other members of staff goes and visits people in their own home. So what can we learn? Well, we had recruitment to the study was lower than anticipated during lockdown, and subsequently there's been issues for data collection, engaging people, and you know, sometimes the last thing that somebody wants to be engaged in is an interview. Developed the adjusting to change model as a framework for data collection, I think is something we could look at as we move forward. The only way to facilitate group work in lockdown was via technology, and we used Zoom, but not everybody did. Zoom was cheap and effective and enhanced relationships, and that enabled that group contact. A minority of meeting centres members have access and digital skills, and staff had to learn very quickly. So one thing I think now as we're opening up a little bit, but perhaps closing down, is utilise the face-to-face contact to develop skills and to develop a training and skills framework. There was a trade-off between flexibility and frequency of contact with duration. So clearly in the meeting centre, people are at the meeting centre in Leinster, sometimes 4 days a week, 5 hours a day. Well, that's clearly something that you can't replicate during lockdown, but it did enable some positive ones. That was flexibility and frequency of contact, particularly for the carers. And I think what we found, as soon as we were able, we had started having picnics in July at the Leinster Meeting Centre. We've had to stop those now, but as soon as they opened, first week, 25 people turned up. It's like a magnet. People want face-to-face contact, and the technology sort of went a little bit by the wayside. So So moving forwards, this sort of maybe a blended approach may enhance this sort of person-centeredness and mitigate against future lockdown or similar situation, which we have to do. So moving forward, the blended approach, sort of remote, a little bit of face-to-face means person-centered support could be optimized, reaching those who can't attend meeting centers and similar types of support. And it could be used in rural areas to address social isolation. It would enable flexibility and consistency should there be future lockdowns. And there's an implication that meeting centres, once regular usual club and family carer sessions are permitted, should direct attention to developing member, family carer and staff digital skills. But that's easier said than done, and that's a next challenge. And well, it's not going to go on forever. That's our meeting centre. So let's look to the future. And there's my references. And that's the end of my presentation.
So thank you. I think it would absolutely resonate with many of the people here. And certainly for me, I think being having to very rapidly adapt how we provided support for people with dementia, and a huge amount of learning about, particularly I think about that point you made at the end, about the things that have really added value, that while they're not right for everyone, that would be something we wouldn't necessarily want to roll back on and build into a blended approach. So I see a couple of people putting hands up. Is that questions or no? Alison, you had a hand up there for a second.
It's just applause.
Oh, applause, right, I don't think so.
Oh.
I need to get with the technology, don't I? Anyway, thank you, Shirley. And when we come by, I'll have a couple of questions for you if we get time later.
Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Matthew JANICKI from the National Task Group of Intellectual Disability and Dementia Practices. I think, Matthew, your presentation is pre-recorded.
Yes, it is.
So I think we're just waiting on that coming on now. Yeah, thank you.
Hi, my name is Matt JANICKI. I'm with the University of Illinois at Chicago in the United States. And my presentation today is going to deal with planning dementia-capable community-based housing for adults with intellectual disabilities. The rationale for planning has to do with the new development of homes around providing dementia care in community settings for both people who are affected by dementia in the general population and those who have specialty needs like intellectual disability. And with planning, knowing something about the dynamics of group home care can help organizations plan proactively for such things as providing post-diagnostic supports, training of staff, and anticipating effects of progression and length of stay. So what's useful to know ahead of time as you think about planning, you know, the purpose of the home, is it to provide temporary care or long-term care? Will the person be there for a short time or there till the end of the life? And then also for planning the changes that the home's residents will experience and when those changes may occur, what staffing needs may be changed as the character of the home changes, what factors may impact the nature of the home and what to expect from the residents, how to factor in shifting changes of the clientele into program practices, financing, and supporting staff. The presentation today is based in part on a study that we've been doing since 2011, a longitudinal study of group homes who are providing specialty dementia care for people with intellectual disabilities. We've been studying a particular program in a Midwestern city in the United States, which contains three purpose-built, five-resident dementia-capable group homes, a cohort of 15, what we call legacy adults with intellectual disabilities, nine of which now have been replaced due to deaths. So it's about 23-24 individuals that we've been following over time. We also have been following 15 community dwelling non-dementia adults with intellectual disabilities, age match controls to compare outcomes. Some of the administrative factors we'll be discussing in terms of planning, admission trends, length of stay, mortality issues, care patterns, and staffing. The critical feature usually is looking at the expected trajectory of progressive dysfunction. What we have here on the slide is a graph from a study taken to the general population, looking at different trajectories of decline over time of individuals who have dementia, who start basically in a somewhat similar way. You can see from the graphic that there's a variation in decline. Some people decline quickly and in a short interval, others linger long and decline slowly over a long period of time. And this is the same thing in terms of group homes with intellectual disabilities. So you have to factor that into planning in terms of how long the home will have the same character as it did when it began and what will be the changes over time. The other factors to consider are degree of retention of function, you know, what kind of skills do people keep over time, what they lose, the duration, which is basically the remaining life years of individuals. So you can plan for the structural changes in the home, and both in terms of patterns of new admissions and staffing assignments, a type of dementia, which can affect the kind of care that people get in terms of staff training. I mean, obviously there are differences in terms of how the presentation of Alzheimer's disease is in terms of behaviors versus those with vascular dementia and other types of dementia. The health status is an issue, you know, what comorbidities people bring to the home when they're admitted. And we know from data that people with dementia tend to have a higher rate of comorbidities than people who don't have dementia. And also the environmental accommodations, you know, what do you have to do to the home to address the issues of change and the factors of the people who are there. One of the things that might be useful to you in planning is looking at admission ages. We have discovered from our studies that there are basically three admit groups. One is a group that enters in about age 50. These are generally people with Down syndrome. And they usually are there because of early aging and precocious aging and early onset Alzheimer's. The second group involves people with Down syndrome and other types of intellectual disability, and they usually get admitted around 57, late 50s. And the third group are individuals who are basically individuals who have intellectual disability and get admitted in the late 60s. So there are three different characteristics, and those may be factored into your planning in terms of how you compose the homes. For example, if you had all people with Down syndrome, that would be a different feature than people who are mixed or only have intellectual disabilities and not Down syndrome. Length of stay is another factor. How long do people remain in the home? Our study shows that the overall mean length of stay is about 4 years post-admission, which means that the people either die or transition to another home over that period of time. Now, some obviously stay longer, some stay shorter, but that's the average time of stay at the home. The graphic here just shows the three homes that we were studying. The colors represent the different homes. The darker color are people with intellectual disabilities, and the lighter color are people with Down syndrome. So you can see the comparisons if you're looking at the slide for a period of time. The implication here is that home composition may change over time, and that could be due to mortality or transitions for people leaving to go to other homes or going to skilled nursing care. So how would deaths affect length of stay? What we find basically is that out of the legacy of individuals that we looked at and studied, the 15, nine died over the 9 years, 60% death rate. The average age of entry of those individuals who came in was 59, and the average mean age of death is 65, and some variations between Down syndrome and intellectual disability. What we found also is that mean age from entry to death is about 5.4 years. So that's another factor in terms of planning, in terms of how long people may be, and also in terms of what you may need for services as people decline. Basically, deaths began 2 years following admission, and that also is affected by the nature of the person's condition when they first got admitted into the dementia care home. Interestingly, the comparison group, our control, is the average age of death for them. There were three of them out of 15, was 78 years of age. So how do resident needs affect staffing? What happens in the homes and when? We use the standardized scale to examine what goes on in a home over a 24-hour period. Staff filled out the chart and indicated what they did each interval of a half hour during a period of 24 hours. And you can see from the graphic, there's a lot of variations in the homes and also variations over time. Obviously, during sleep times, there's little staff activity, but during the day, there's a varied amount of activity. And it also varies in terms of the nature of the individuals. If there are people who have advanced dementia or most progressive dementia, there's more activity in terms of self-care of the individuals. If people have less affected dementia, they may be out of the home during the day, so there's less involvement. What we found basically is that most time was spent on toileting aid. eating, drinking assistance, the ADL types of things, activities of daily living, activities, and behavior management. Those are the three focus areas. And we also found the staff numbers varied by home based on the resident factors and level of care needs. So the individuals who were most impaired needed less number of staff because of the nature of their presentation. People that are least impaired, who moved around a lot, needed more staff to engage them. So the planning implications for homes include things like location, safety, utility, and design. Obviously, with location, you're looking at normative appearance and siding, so you want the homes to blend in with the community look, the neighborhood look, and also would be functional. So you want to have ease of access also to off-housing resources and amenities so they're not located in isolated areas. Safety features, you control egress and facilitate outdoor use. In other words, you don't want people walking out of the home and wandering into perhaps dangerous situations where there may be traffic or other features. You have to think about evacuation factors like fire evacuation or other emergencies, considering wandering paths so people can move around outside if you do have the luxury of a yard or a backyard area where people can do that in an enclosed environment. And you want to institute minimization of risk things in the home. Utility, single story, usually because with people's lack of ambulation sometimes or decreasing ambulation, you don't want to have to worry about stairs and elevators. And also you want to have a single story design where people don't have to worry about wheelchair blockage in terms of multi-levels in the first floor, in the single story. And with progressive dementia, people tend to lose their ambulation skills, which then presents more people using wheelchairs. And also think about privacy in public spaces. And in terms of design, you want to have plan for transitions with decline. So what happens in the home is that as people change, there needs to be the accommodation for that change in the home. And then the functionality issues such as bathing spaces, common areas, colors and lighting. These are all features that are found in common dementia design recommendations and techniques. So you can look those up. So these are planning things in terms of looking at the structures. The last kind of considerations are really what think about in terms of how to want the home to be designed, the structure. Is the building set up for dementia care, for example? Is it single level? Is there lighting that's sufficient? Is there barrier free? Is there outdoor space open to the air, for example, if you have enclosed spaces? You know, have staff, what's the kind of specialized training that staff will be receiving? Hopefully they'll be receiving staff training above and beyond the typical training they get as for caring for people with intellectual disabilities because of the nature of dementia. And at what point does your agency admit to the home? What are the criteria for admission to a firm based on dementia? Is the suspicion of dementia, diagnosed dementia, and what level? And also matching them to the level of other residents in the home, is that a factor? At what point does your agency terminate care? Are there times when you time out an individual or you don't have the capacity to provide non-ambulatory care? Or if you do, then you know what are the policies in terms of that feature? Did you have end-of-life options to be provided? And then how to individualize the daily support program. The degree of involvement in the community, for example, is an issue. How to adapt programs to change in functions. And will the resident stay in place during the day or leave during the day? And then is the program adaptable for advanced dementia care? And then what are the attitudes and capabilities of staff? If you transition staff from generic group homes, they are very capable of dealing with people with intellectual disability. Do they have the same skill set to work with dementia people with dementia, for example? Are they comfortable with dementia capable care and the kinds of issues that go on, you know, and their skill sets are there? And then what are the training and clinical supports that might enable staff to continue to provide care for dementia and the individuals be assessed periodically who have dementia? So the takeaways I will leave you with include things like the varied trajectories of decline. Keep that in mind because there are going to be variations in the homes. The homes in 5 years will not look like the homes the first year, and maybe 10 years later they won't either. So you have to think about whether the replacement of individuals is based on the general character of the home at the time, or you're starting over and you're starting to put people into the home or admit people into the home who have basic needs for dementia care. And then the mortality issues, you know, they're usually linked to the complexity of pre-existing conditions and progression of dementia. People may die from things that are not related to dementia if they have other conditions that are more pressing. And then the changes in the focus of care needs over time, you know, including advanced dementia, if the residents stay in place. These are the things to consider as well. So in essence, dementia care home group homes can enable agencies to provide in community group housing and quality care, and in accord with stage-defined functional changes and needs, if structured in a planful way. And that's the critical thing, planning ahead, thinking about what the design would be, how you were going to accommodate things, and deal with other issues that come up. Our study information is at this URL. You can welcome to review it. It's at our website. If you have any questions, feel free to contact me at the university. I'd be glad to answer them. Thank you very much.
Matthew, thank you. I really interested in that question. Some of the questions you were posing there, and maybe come back to this, that question about how the group homes might look in 5 or 10 years' time, and I wonder to what extent there's a lesson there to be learned, actually, about how we plan communities and build homes that are adaptable to changing needs through all of our lives, actually, and supporting people to continue to live in the communities and the homes that they perhaps have always lived in. So maybe we can come back to that later in the discussion. Okay, thank you. Shirley, I had a question for you around the meeting centres, and I suppose it was just a fairly straightforward question, about how are they funded? There's a bit of a structure around those in terms of staffing, and I know they're based in community-based buildings, are they commissioned by individual authorities or no?
No, that's the aim down the line to generate sufficient evidence for it. But they're generally owned by a charity. I mean, so in Leinster, it was part of the Meeting Den project. And after that finished, JoyReach2, we set up a charity and we run that. And the aim is to have about 30% income from participant fees, 30% from grants and 30% from community fundraising. And Leinster costs about £62,000 last year. It's open 4 days a week with 3 staff and a really good deal with the council on the premises. So we've got some national lottery funding for 3 years. That gives us £30,000 a year. Then we've got participant fees. We charge a membership fee per month, and that's been great because they continue to pay that during lockdown. So that model works really well. So we brought in about £20,000 from that. And obviously our community fundraising took a bit of a hit in the summer because we couldn't do anything. So that's the sort of thing.
Shirley, thank you. You know, as I said earlier, I absolutely recognise what you described about that, you know, need to rapidly transition how and adapt to how you continue to support people throughout this pandemic, while many of the community-based supports that people relied on were unable to run because of the restrictions in place. So I think many people on the call will probably recognise that need to adapt very quickly.
That remote support is interesting because it takes more staffing. It's a bit like online learning. You know, you think you go online and it's going to be a cheap option. It's not. You
still have it. Yeah, I've got calls to make.
Okay, so Rachel, were you, sorry. I think that was maybe just a mic that was unmuted. Alison, there are one or two comments on your presentation. I know that one of my colleagues here from Scotland is in the call, Julie, and Julie's been involved in our NHS healthcare, the National Health Service Healthcare Improvement Scotland work, which is around the post-diagnostic support improvement work in Scotland, and particularly looking at, they're involved in all of it, but a particular strand of work looking at post-diagnostic support and primary care. Julie, do you want to say anything about that and how that might relate to what Alison was saying? Or?
Yeah, can you hear me, Jim?
I can, yeah.
Sorry, I'm not putting my camera on because I'm not looking my best. I'm not my lipstick on. I didn't think I was going to be on camera. It's just really interesting to see Alison's things. And I think actually at one point I did give pre-dem some of the information of our work as it was starting. So yeah, just I could just see two of the points that Alison picked out there that are related to our model and the areas that we're testing in. So there's obviously the dementia, we've got a dementia support facilitator, which is a dementia practitioner based in primary care in one of the sites. And the other two sites, there's three sites in total, the other two sites are set that more secondary care led model that are much more aligned to primary care. So they've been allowed to innovate. So we've got three kind of different models going on there. And it was just interesting to see Alison's findings there about there being no single best model of post-diagnostic support, that no sites do everything well. And the external evaluation of our model is just about to start. So I don't want to preempt any of the findings of that. It's obviously independent evaluators are going to look at that work. But yeah, I do have, between us and between everybody on the call, I do wonder whether there's elements from each of the sites that might make up the perfect model. I don't know if either of them are the perfect model at this stage, but we'll see what the evaluation picks out. But certainly with the one where they've got the practitioner based right in primary care, I've mentioned in the chat box there, there's some really nice links to the GP system, you know, having access for a practitioner to get right into patients' notes and be able to update notes with, in relation to their dementia and their needs and that they're getting already. I think that's been a really nice feature of that programme so far, and it'll be interesting to see, as I say, more detail of that in the evaluation. Others have focused on actually holding clinics within primary care with respect to people receiving a diagnosis in the GP surgery. So that's been interesting work, and obviously that's had to be pulled for now because of COVID-19. We can't have people dropping into clinics and attending clinics in primary care. So some of the work's been quite a bit affected over this lockdown period. So that's probably all I should be saying just now about that work. But as I say, if people want to have a look at the link there, you know, there's other work that we've been doing that relate to post-diagnostic support generally. And I think if we're not saying, you know, it has to be based in one certain place, there might be it might be worth people looking at the quality improvement framework, which lays out what a good service should look like, irrespective of where it's delivered from. So, sorry, that's probably all I should say just now, Jim, if that's okay. I don't want to take up too much time.
No, that's fine. Thank you, Julie. And thank you for contributing. Karen Denning, Alison made a point, which I think was quite interesting. And I had the same question in my head. And you mentioned about those various different components. So not everyone is delivering everything, but sometimes when you look at all of the parts of the system, that there's a contribution. But the key part of that is, how do you link it together? And in particular, I think, how do you link that together in a way that it feels coordinated around the life of the person with dementia and their families and carers? So do you want to maybe touch on a little bit about that? I think that's a really important point about how that's all brought together and connected.
Yeah, well, I think it's really the crux of the issue, because we went in looking for models, but as I said, it kind of turned out that actually there's not really one model that you want to impose on everyone. So we started thinking that actually let's look at what's already there and see about how we can link it together. I think it kind of relates to what Julie was just saying, but the admiral nurse based in a GP practice model was also kind of working directly with GPs, contributing to GP notes. And I think that was what quite streamlined in terms of making sure things were picked up in a timely fashion and making sure nobody fell through the cracks. But we also saw examples of secondary care and primary care linking up really well using shared care agreements. So I think really the thing is having something formally in place, having everybody on the same page so that you know who's responsible for what aspects of care, and also that you know what's out there, because we found that actually a lot of times people didn't know everything that was out there. And the people that did know everything that was out there tended to be more in terms of the dementia navigators, so kind of Alzheimer's Society dementia navigators, other charity workers that knew a lot about a very specific local area. So that kind of knowledge was also really valuable. So finding ways to link that to what's happening in primary care and secondary care is also really important.
Yeah, which just reinforces the point, I suppose, isn't it, that if some professionals find it hard to know what's all out there.
Absolutely.
How do people with dementia and how do carers navigate their way around that? How do you make that feel coordinated for them? And while there's no real, no absolutely definitive model of post-diagnostic support, I think there are perhaps some really underpinning values and principles about what that means for the person with dementia and the family, what's important to them. And yeah. Okay, so there was another little question that popped in at the end, I think. That was a question. So Joe, you made a comment about primary care practitioners. Do you want to add to that at all, or?
No, it was just pointing out how it works differently in different parts of the countries.
Okay.
We all kind of do the same thing, but in our own sort of own special ways.
Okay, thank you. Is there anyone else got any questions for any of our speakers today?
Can I ask a question about, did Alison publish already her work? I see something in the chat here about Midlothian report or something like that. Is that it? Or
I think that's the one that Julie was talking about.
Okay.
So we haven't published this part yet.
Not yet,
but hopefully soon.
Okay, because I thought that the picture was really nice you showed with all the different functionalities which are needed.
Yeah, great.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, that was a helpful slide. Yeah, the Julie, a colleague of ours here in Scotland had, I don't know whether Julie, you could even put a link to that report. But it was an evaluation of one of the test sites of one of Scotland's national dementia strategies around coordinated care for people with dementia. And this is an independently evaluated report about the critical success factors of that. But I'm sure we can share that in the chat here.
Yeah, Jim, sorry, it's Julie. If people just click on that link, it takes you to that page, and it's on that same page that I put the link to the other one.
Link that was in the earlier one? Thank you.
Yeah, so people can just use that and see the whole page and all of the work. Just some of the key factors were about have that single point of access, having a co-located team, that sort of thing, a good interface with the third sector. You know, those were some of the critical success factors. But people can have a look at the report. It's just out, so... Okay, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Any other questions? There are about three. Oh, Henrietta.
Yeah, thank you. It's because I have the camera, so you see me waving. Yeah. I have a quick question for Matthew. It's maybe not so quick, but how do you see the development of the group housing in comparison to the traditional nursing homes in the future? How do you think they will relate to each other in, let's say, 10, 15 years? Will you have different populations or different arrangements?
Well, the group homes are something that have evolved in the area of intellectual disability support housing. And with dementia, they're kind of re-emerging, I think, with a stronger interest in many countries as an alternative to being placed in a long-term care facility, institutional facility like a skilled nursing home. So the idea in terms of setting these up is to think about what factors would help enable people to stay in the homes until the end of care, and also how do you design potentially some transitions. The reason I was looking at the project in the three homes is that there's some thinking about that you may specialize some of the homes depending on the stage of dementia that you're in. Obviously, the advanced dementia provides a different level of care and sometimes a different level of accommodation in the home because people would tend not to be ambulatory to a large extent on their own. And consequently, the level of training of staff is directed towards skilled nursing as opposed to social care. The other homes are really, the other levels really deal with perhaps the function of individuals in terms of how involved they can get in activities. So the idea really is to try to establish I guess, you know, within nations, networks of homes that would provide the bridge between home care, which is where families would provide the primary care, but they oftentimes age out because their parents are older than most people who have disabilities, and to eliminate the need to have to go into a kind of a congregate care center. So that would be the function of the homes. Over time, I would hope that, you know, they would develop a technology and a kind of a ethos that would look at how the homes function well in a community and how the distributed system might be shared among agencies to care for different levels of care.
Thank you. I would like to talk further about this with you in our study, but I will contact you.
Yeah, please do.
Thank you.
Thank you, Henrietta. Any other questions for our speakers? I don't see, and I'm just scanning through the participants. I don't see that anybody's got a digitally raised hand, and I don't see anybody waving at me on the screen. So I just wonder, well, we've actually been doing okay for time. I think we have some time left. I wonder whether it might be helpful just to give each of our speakers a minute or so, just each, just to, if there's anything that you want to add or respond to. I don't think there was any particular questions in the chat. There was one or two points being made, but not necessarily questions. Shirley, is there anything else that you would like to add?
Our project, it's lottery funded project, the UK Meeting Centre Support Programme. And part of that is about setting up new meeting centres, which clearly has been difficult in this period, but there's been, you know, a significant amount of interest. And I think it's that thinking ahead and planning ahead is so important for when we come out of this. And it's going to be well into next year before something like meeting centres can open properly, you know, we're looking at next May, probably at the earliest. But we have had some initiatives with people setting up what we're calling an online meeting point, which is completely virtual, with a view to that expanding as we come out of that. And we've certainly been doing that in Herefordshire, and we set something up with a view to people who have never met carers and people with dementia who have never met each other face to face. So they're coming together online, and the view is that from this we will emerge and actually end up meeting face to face. But I've got another project called Community Makers, which is a resource for supporting people who support people online. It's a resource and a network and a community of learning and practice. So it is aligned, and there's a lot of synergy with meeting centres. And I'll just put the link to the Community Makers website, and people might want to have a look at that because it's free and it's any for anyone to look at. And we also have a network that if people want to join about sharing resources, about sharing learning, about how to support people with dementia and family carers online, that would be great. So that's what I wanted to say.
Thank you, Shirley. And actually, I need to apologise to you all because apparently we didn't have as much time as I thought we had, and our moderator has just reminded me of that. And unfortunately, I have to bring the time to a close. I do apologise to the other speakers as well. But thank you, and thank you all so much for participating and participating in the chat. And a digital round of applause, I think, for all of our speakers today would be helpful. Thank you. Thank you very much. Bye. Thank you.
Thanks, Jim. Bye-bye. Thanks, Jim, for sharing.
Thanks, Jim.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Bye.
Bye.